Hi everyone, in this video I will be giving you tips on how to improve soil fertility. Hi everyone, my name is Eva. I'm from a company called Gran Visio, and I've created the business together with my partner to help people manage their land more efficiently. And in today's video, I will be talking about soil fertility, and that will be from a permaculture viewpoint. And if you don't know what permaculture is, it is just the opposite of monoculture. And monoculture is the modern agricultural system where, for example, on a field, one would grow just one crop, the soil would be plowed, and in most cases, just chemical fertilizers applied to the soil. And in permaculture, we aim for maximum diversity. We plant different species together, especially those that have beneficial effect on our productive species. So we don't have to worry about diseases, insects, and so on. We would also place appropriate elements in appropriate location in the landscape so everything can work harmoniously. All right, so let's start with tip number one. So tip number one is to understand nature. I think it's of utmost importance that we understand how exactly the wild green areas of Earth function without any human input. Because if we understand those processes, we could mimic them in our gardens and on our fields. So what happens is, in the forest, like everything grows, there's so many species, there's such a biodiversity. If we don't intervene and cut and like plant just one type, for example, of trees, for example, a pine on a huge amount of area, if we look at jungles and wild forests, we will notice berry bushes, different bushes like roots, vines, different trees, because the species and what's happening with the trees, they are self-fertile. So there is self-fertilization process going on. And this occurs by branches and leaves and different materials falling on forest floor. And some animals like birds and other wild animals leave their manure. And all those different ingredients, materials in the forest decompose. Otherwise, we will be having a huge pile of material and we wouldn't be able to walk through. But the nature is perfectly designed. So when the forest floor becomes moist, microorganisms take over and they help to decompose those materials. And when they decompose, we have humus at top, rich dark soil full of minerals and available to roots of all the species in the forest, including trees. However, for some plants to be able to digest these nutrients, there are other types of microorganisms helping them to absorb them. And they need special conditions to thrive. And these conditions are moisture and undisturbed ground. Now that we understand those processes, we can move on to tip number two, which is about returning organic matter to the soil. Organic matter really helps to improve structure and granularity of the soil. The soil becomes like a sponge, so every time it rains or we irrigate, it better absorbs water and roots of the plants grow better. There are less diseases because of that perfect crumbly structure. And we're not even talking about the nutrients, which are so important. If you decide to just rely on chemical fertilizers, you will find yourself in a dead end because, yes, you will be giving the plants nutrients. However, without organic matter, the soil is lifeless. There are no organisms, there are no microorganisms. So it's really difficult for plants to digest the food that you're giving them, but also you're finding yourself in a situation where there are diseases and insects attacking your plants. If, on the other hand, you make the soil richer in organic matter, you will have far less problems with any sort of bugs attacking your plants because they will have better conditions to grow. So now let's move on to tip number three, which is about making compost. It is one way that we can ensure organic matter is returned to the soil. And compost, you can imagine this as rolling up all the forest ingredients into the pile and wait for the decomposition process to kick in and for that rich, dark topsoil to be put on garden beds or on field. So when you assemble appropriate materials, for example, green material, which can be anything from grass clippings, weeds, kitchen scraps, discarded fruits. And if you mix that with brown material, which is hay, straw, leaves, fallen leaves, brown leaves, pine needles. So if you mix green and brown, and a bonus is if you add animal manure to it, that means all the processes will be much quicker. So you wouldn't have to wait for the result that long. So if you do that and layer them, green, brown manure, green, brown manure, green, brown manure, and you make piles of one cubic meters, it's just perfect. If you're in a situation that we're in, for example, we're growing veggies whole year, the best way to ensure the plants have nutrients ready is to just add compost. Another huge advantage of compost is that it increases the population of earthworms. And earthworms are so important because they not only burrow through the soil and make it more fluffy so that the roots of your plants can grow much easier, but they also leave manure, and it's called worm castings. So worm castings give the soil 5 times more nitrogen, 7 times more phosphate, and 11 times more potash than the soil they were existing in. So it's just incredible what nature does for us. All right, everyone, thanks so much for watching that far. We're moving to tip number four, which is about using special types of species. They are called cover crops or legumes. And the reason why they are so special is that they have a microbe living on them, and the microbe is able to utilize nitrogen from air and accumulate it around the roots of plants, as well as trees. And it also helps plants to absorb that nitrogen. So it's quite incredible. People spend money on chemical fertilizers that include nitrogen, which is the most important plant nutrient. However, nitrogen is in abundance in the air, and it can be used for free. So yeah, I highly recommend you to use those crops. So these cover crops are commonly known by most people on Earth, if not all people on Earth. These are beans, broad beans, green beans, all kinds of beans, peas, cowpeas, also clovers, alfalfa, and there are so many other types. So it's incredible. We can use them to fix nitrogen to either to beds or fields so that later on the main crop is planted, or, and I think that's an even better idea, you could plant those species along your main crop or your productive species in the garden. So you need to choose whatever sort of scenario works for you best. Speaking about plants fixing nitrogen, I made a list of all I could find on the internet, and I separated them according to USDA hardiness zones. There are over 400 unique species here, and this 37-page document could be yours if you just follow the link to my online shop. It will only cost you €2. All right, I need to tell you one more thing. There are also legume trees, and they play the same function that the cover crops I have just discussed. They can fix nitrogen from the air, and they are super beneficial in establishing orchards because they help the productive trees. They give them nitrogen for free. And I think the most common are acacia, prosopis, casuarina, and pseudo acacia, which is, I think, all over the Europe. apart from planting it, like intercropping it between your productive trees, you could use also their material as a mulch. And I will be talking about mulching just in a bit. But it's just incredible that you could chop the green material of those trees because they are designed to be sacrificial ones. It's absolutely fine. They regrow. Don't do it in the summer because you can kill it. Just before a pseudo acacia drops its leaves, you could use them, collect them, and put it near your productive trees or your garden beds if you fancy. Okay, everyone, final tip number 5 for this video. It's about using mulch. And mulch is a material that is placed on garden beds to protect it from wind and protect it from heat. So it especially benefits gardeners and farmers in hot climates. But I think it can also be used in colder climates if you want to extend the growing season and protect the soil from too much cold. However, there is one important condition. You should be using raised garden beds. So beds that are a bit raised above the footpath in your garden. Because if you lay mulch on the bed that is sort of at this ground level, there is a possibility that there might be occurring some waterlogging and, you know, rotting could occur and this could encourage snails. So yes, raised garden beds are superb for using mulch. The mulch is the material that could comprise of hay, straw, for example, bamboo leaves, grass, rice grass, anything that is organic and anything that can rot over time. So you can use your imagination and it's really great because whenever it rains, it will allow the nutrients from the lower bottom of mulch to penetrate the soil. And your plants will be able to, you know, digest those nutrients. Another advantage of using mulch is that it suppresses the growth of weeds. Because if you put a thick mulch on your garden beds, no weeds will come up, especially if you do it quite early in the season. You shouldn't put mulch when the seedlings are small, because it's possible that their little leaves might touch the mulch that, for example, becomes wet after raining and that there could be some disease going on. So it's better wait for plants to be mature and then put mulch. And of course, if you could start seedlings indoors and have the big plants ready to be planted in the garden, that's even better because you could put mulch on your garden bed, covered with compost, and you could make a hole in the garden bed and just put your seedlings right in the bed. And, you know, the mulch is already surrounding the plant. So I think that's a really time efficient way of planting the seedlings that will be already protected from, you know, too much wind or too much rain or too much sun. So yeah, I absolutely love this method of gardening. So yeah, as you could see, I'm quite excited about telling you all about these methods, these actually easy methods of delivering nutrients to soil and improving soil fertility, structure and granularity. So if you liked this video, just give it a thumbs up, consider subscribing. And if you have any questions, as always, please leave the comment below. And yeah, I will respond as soon as I can. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.